brothers and sisters, I extremely feel great honor meeting with you and speak. And I think afterward, good interaction, question and answer. I prefer that. Yesterday, very good function, but no question. So I feel something missing. I love questions to answer. And sometimes including argument. So now, late Christian, somewhere. Oh. Actually, as you mentioned also, as my landlord, 1959, under the difficult circumstances in Tibet. That difficulty is not all the certain, you see, develop, no. Mainly since 56. You see, because of the Chinese communist, they carry reform. Yes, we Tibet need reform, but reform should be realistic and according to reality, not just impose. So the Chinese, you see, Chinese communist, you see, they start reform according the style which they carry in their own land, in Chinese community. They are, I think, landlord exploitation, I think, very serious. In Tibet area, at least, you see, the whole country, you see, following Buddha's message of love, even towards a small insect, we always say, don't kill, don't harm. So that kind of society, so although theoretically feudal system, but the reality, very, very compassionate society. So when the Chinese start reform according to their own way, then a lot of resentment, including those slaves, very much resented. So the response from the Chinese authority, suppression. Then 56, the open revolt started. Then that situation become worse and worse. Firstly, 56 in Kham area, then 57 in Amdo area, then whole, then 50, gradually 58, whole Tibet, then uprising. So then, at that difficult circumstances, we try our best, is it to cool down the situation, but completely fail. Then finally, no other choice except escape. I think I may share this sort of information. At the 10th March, 59, whole thousand people raised their voice and came to Noblinga summer palace. Then they stationed there. They supposed to see, they felt, you see, at that time, the 10th of March, that very day, already some sort of plan. I go to the Chinese military headquarters, some performance. So when that news spread Lhasa, then the people really felt that in many cases in 57, 56 in Tibet, often Chinese authority invite some Tibetan leaders and some spiritual leaders, when they reach a Chinese military headquarters, arrest. So people there are very much afraid, very fear. So they almost, I think, 90% of Tibetan, lots of population, come to Noblinga, try to stop me, go there. Then the crisis happened. About a week, I try cool down the situation. One side try to tell Tibetan, you should not remain as a big number, that some few representatives can stay Noblinga. And in the meantime, I also wrote a letter to then Chinese military leader, the Zhang Guoha, then General Zhang Guoha, and at that moment, not in Lhasa, but another one. He, not very intelligent person. So he was there. So I wrote three letters to him, try to cool down the situation. But finally, I received one message in Summer Palace, Noblinga, the which house, which room you stay should mark and then send it to him. So he will going to protect that. Meantime, since 10th March, every night, troop movement, very seriously, big number will come. And then, I think, 15th or 16th, in front of Potala, there's a big Chinese military garrison, garrison somewhere, and with artillery. So usually these artillery covered. Then around, I think, 16th or 15th, all cover, remove. That notice from Potala. So then you see that letter, either protect or target. Not very clear. So then finally, seventeenth March, I decide now better to escape from Lhasa, at least to southern Tibet. So that night I left. So then, eventually, original our idea is escape to southern Tibet. Then we may have some kind of talk with Chinese leaders. But then, 17th night I left. The 19th bombard started. So then, no other way except escape. Then towards southern border. So we are not very sure whether Indian government allowed us or not. So we sent two delegations, one towards Bhutan, one towards India. Then we received sort of information, the Indian side ready to accept us. So then we were very much relieved. And then went towards Kanzamani and Tawang area. So that's the new life started from that day. So now, April 1959, I reached Mussoorie. And soon after I reached there, Pandit Nehru came to see me. And a lot of sorosity. And firstly, report. Because in 1956, I came to India, Buddha Jayanti celebration. So, during that moment, many Tibetans urged me, now better to stay in India, not to return. I discussed Pandit Nehru. Then, Pandit Nehru, one day, took in his hand one copy of 17-point agreement. Then he, pointing certain, what's it, cross on this, on the basis of this cross, you can carry Stakar within Tibet. It is better to return. So he has some moral responsibility. When they received information, Dalai Lama left from Lhasa, now going towards India. Then at that time, at the cabinet meeting, when that news reached, and some minister say, oh, Dalai Lama should not allow come here because the sensitive relation with China. But then Pandit Nehru himself decide, no, we must accept asylum, Dalai Lama. So when I reached Kanzamani, I saw some officials. Since I know 56 very well, so when I saw their face smiling, I really feel, oh, something now safe. So very, very happy moment. This one of the happiest moments of my whole life. So and then came to Mussoorie. Mussoorie, the government of India arranged my sort of residence. 1 year at Kasa, Mussoorie. Then more or less permanent residence, the government choose the Dharamsala. Then summer 60, I reached Dharamsala. Then first few years, the Saw Ashram, my home. And that, quite sort of Sudha. There's no place to expand. So then, the your place, we thought that's a nice place, suitable place. Then I appeal or contact there when the father. Then he very much sort of happy give us, you see, that building. Then I think at that time, I think 100,000 rupee with that I bought. So their family become my landlord. So then, that place quite open. So there's possibility to our own constructions, these things. So eventually, you see, they, beside the old, their home, old but very sort of stable, very good. I spent a few years there. Then, meanwhile, new constructions, like that. So, that's the, I think, my new life as the guest of Indian government, more or less permanent residence now, that area. So, now nearly 60 years passed. I feel meaningful life. Our relation, India, Tibet, over 1,000 years, since 7th century, or 8th century, you see, 7th century Tibetan emperor, you see, developed Tibetan writing, copy, Devanagari, one Indian script and alphabet, Kakakana. Sometimes I feel the seventh century, the Tibetan emperor married with Chinese princess Tang, so also the Tang emperor's daughter, Mary. But I think the Tibetan king, emperor, I think find the Chinese letter is too complicated. So he prefer copy from one Indian sort of Devanagari, Kakakanga, like that, alphabet, Kakakanga, like that. Then 8th century, although influenced Buddhism to Tibet, I think originally come from China. But then the 8th century Tibetan emperor, you see, he decide to invite the 8th century, at that time, Nalanda institution, you see, highly because of the flourishing. So he invited almost the top master, scholar, logician, monk, Shantarakshita, invited to Tibet. He introduced Buddha Dharma according Nalanda tradition. So I always was telling you Indian, traditionally our teacher, our guru, we are chela, student. And I'm mentioning we are quite reliable chela. Over 1,000 years, we sincerely, seriously kept the Nalanda tradition through rigorous study and utilize logic maximum way. So therefore, as a result, now may I tell you, as a result, now I think the traditional, our guru, too much westernized, not much pay attention about the Nalanda tradition. So we chela, we really kept all this knowledge. So now in reality, the traditional chela become teacher. That's, I don't know. Fortunate or unfortunate, I don't know. So we have some special connection, India, Tibet. So when we first, 1956, came here, and then 1959 as a refugee, but we feel we return spiritually our original, our home. And then beside that, Pandit Nehru, since 56, become very close, trusted sort of friend. So Governor of India, you see, take care, not only me, about 80,000 refugees at that time. So we Tibetan, the settlement, and also the student, the school for Tibetan student, we re-established some historical important the monastic institution also re-established. Now, pure Tibetan culture. Inside Tibet, little difficult, But outside here in India, you see, we have the opportunity to re-establish like that. So we are quite, I think, successful refugee community. All these possible because of Government of India's help and various state government, including Jammu Kashmir, and these all these different states, very much supportive, and the Karnataka state, and all these. So as a result, now we small about 100,000 refugee community, quite well established. Meantime, we carry 1,000-year-old our tradition, our knowledge. So now we have some sort of confidence we can serve regarding revival of ancient Indian knowledge in modern India. I usually is telling ancient Indian knowledge, you see, how to tackle our emotion. Not through prayer, but through reasoning. With full knowledge about the whole system of our emotion, our mind. So that, I think we found very, very useful, particularly when we're passing through a difficult period. This ancient Indian knowledge is immense helpful to keep our mind peaceful. So therefore, now my latest commitment is try to revival of this ancient Indian knowledge, mainly psychology, these things to revival in modern India. India is the only nation out of 200 different nations, only India is the only nation who have the ability to combine ancient Indian knowledge about our mind, which brings inner peace, and then modern education, modern knowledge, technology, science, these things, you're highly developed, so you can combine these two things. So material-oriented sort of education and these things provide us physical health. But then ancient Indian knowledge give us mental health. These days, I'm telling, the hygiene of physical must combine hygiene of emotion. Very important. I think the whole world passing through some kind of crisis of emotion. Isn't it? So therefore, India, I think, firstly, revival, these ancient Indian knowledge and combine modern education, ancient Indian education, knowledge combined. Then India, over a billion populated nation, you can make a certain contribution to, firstly, whole Asian countries. All Asian countries are following Buddhism, Buddhism from India. So India's sort of certain sort of experience certainly can help this, including China. Then combine China, India combined. Then about 2.5 billion human beings, quite big. So certainly can make contribution, significant contribution for world peace. World peace, not through prayer, not through resolution, but through inner peace. So, as a refugee, it is our moral responsibility, what we learned from this country, from that knowledge, now it is our duty to make a contribution as much as we can. So our refugee life become meaningful life. Okay. So that, then here, Kasa Tropic, Kasa Shik Seventh, ethics, happiness. Happiness, even animals, without sophisticated language, they also want happiness. Insect also, everyone. So no need complicated explanation about happiness or joyfulness. Now the question is, yesterday also I mentioned all sentient being, and particularly we human being, all want joyful life, no question. At the very basis of that joyfulness, very much related with human love, compassion. As soon as we're born, mother take care, give milk. So long, mother, you see the kasoda, bring away. Together, the child, very happy, very safe. So, the next few years, mother's affection is the key factor for survival and happy boy, happy children. So, that's human nature. Nothing to do with religion, but human nature. We are a social animal. So, individual survival entirely depends on others' care, on the community. So therefore, now some scientists say basic human nature is more compassionate. And also they say the constant anger, fear is actually eating our immune system. Whereas more compassionate mind, more peaceful mind, our physical health much better can maintain our immune system. So these not religious sort of teaching, this is scientific sort of finding like that. So then basically we are, as a social animal, everybody have the sort of deeper experience of compassion and the seed of compassion there. But the problem now I want to share with you is the education. The modern education very much oriented about material value. So children once join school, no lesson how much importance about this deeper inner value. So then children mainly talking about materialistic life, materialistic culture, not much talk about this deeper inner value. So now education, as I mentioned earlier, must include education about our inner value. So in any way, the ethics means something good to others as well as to oneself. That's any action, verbal action, physical action, mental action, which brings some joyfulness to other, that's an ethical thing. Ethic, not necessarily believe some mysterious thing, simply dangerous life. You see, happy. And surrounded yourself, including animals, also you see, feel happy. So the thing which created that kind of atmosphere, that's ethical sort of action. Okay, like that. So that I want to share with you. Now questions. Come, question.
As somebody who spent a large portion of my life in television news before I quit it a short while back, it strikes me that a lot of the information that we are getting these days neither makes for ethics or happiness. You know, if you see people screaming at each other all the time on television, it doesn't add much to your happiness. Do you think in the modern era, information that we are getting and the way that we are getting increasingly high-pitched in our conduct with each other, that is going to cause a serious question on the future of us, of our sense and of our happiness.
Now, at present, life, because of the education, just materialistic oriented education. So whole generation come from that kind of education. Then they create materialistic life, materialistic culture. So that cannot change overnight. We have to think seriously, the kindergarten level, how to start education, more complete form of education. Material value, physical health, and mental health. Not touching religion. Again, India's secular, wonderful, very realistic, very practical. According to Indian understanding, secular means respect all religion and also respect non-believer. That's wonderful. Now, out of 7 billion human beings, about 1 billion non-believer. So these also human brothers, sisters, we must, including these non-believer. So any sort of ethics or inner value, you see, based on religious faith, then these people don't care. So Indian sort of tradition, secular way, approach these inner value. So I think if we start some proper sort of plan with vision, then after 15 years, 20 years, 30 years, through that kind of education, then the different society, different sort of cultural heritage can develop. Otherwise, you see, the materialistic sort of education, through that way, materialistic life, materialistic culture. Materialistic culture, seeing something nice, and music, and food, and touch, including sex. These are supreme, without knowing the deeper value of our human mind. Because of that, yesterday also I mentioned, everybody like happy life. Happiness very much depends on warm-heartedness. But human intelligence, wonderful human intelligence, but that intelligence much more connected with anger. Anger brings suspicion, distrust. And then anger, greedy, you see these, you see, very much influence our intelligence. So our intelligence, you see, there is great potential, you see, to increase our affection, our love. Animal, without that intelligence, social animal, they have certain limited altruism there, very limited. But we human beings, because of this brain, we have ability to increase infinite kasa, infinite altruism. Only human being can do. Now in the past, this all major religious tradition carry this message. Wonderful. Now, as I mentioned earlier, there are large number of non-believer, and among the believer also, they although they are sort of tradition, religion, carry a message of love, but religion itself now causing division, killing. So lack of conviction, this deeper value. If you have deeper conviction about this deeper value, then all major religious tradition carry the same message of love, forgiveness, tolerance, these things. In spite of different philosophical views. Some say there's God, some say no God. Jainism, Buddhism, and one part of Sanghyasim, no concept of creator. So do you consider Buddhist, including myself, is Kasadiminti. Ka. Nihilist. Since we do not believe God. What do you think?
No question about
that. So, philosophical feet, big differences. Sangya, one part of Sangya philosophy, over 3,000 years. One part say, no God, no creator. Atma, no beginning, no end. So life after life. So, so Sangya philosophy and Jain philosophy and Buddhist philosophy, these philosophy consider oneself as a creator. So consider self-creation. Like that. So in philosophical field, big differences. Judeo-Christian tradition and Islam also, you see, consider God, creator. Big differences, but all carry the message of love. And Christian believe we all created by one God. That's almost like our father. Thinking that seriously, then entire human being are truly brothers, sisters from one father. That father, infinite love. So if you truly believe that, sincerely, seriously practice that wonderful teaching. Like that, so therefore, in philosophical field, there's a lot of differences. And within Buddhist tradition, the Vivasek, Kasasodantik, and Chitta Mantra, and Madhyamika, four major school of thought. There's big differences in philosophical view. And within these, particularly Chitta Mantra and Madhyamika, there are subdivisions. There are a lot of differences, a lot of argument, like that. So these all aim, to improve oneself, to change our emotion. Now quantum physicists also now, some quantum physicists, they begin to feel those quantum physicists, he sincerely believe, he or she sincerely believe, things does not exist as appears. So, such sort of scientist, mental exaggeration is much less. One of my American friend, Rajaram Kaza, Aaron Beck, he not a religious person, I think scientist. So he helping many decades those people who too much mental stress or mental unrest due to anger. His conclusion was the person who feel angry towards mainly human being, that human being appears very negative. But actually, 90% of that negativeness is mental projection, not true. So that very much connected with the view you believe on the level of appearances, not the deeper level. So it is very important to make distinction, deeper reality and appearances. Now that quantum physics also, you see, very well explain that. So Madhyamika philosophy also similar. There's big differences, appearances and deeper reality. So therefore, through education, if we educate people, not only external, not only relying on sensorial experiences, but deeper level. Compassion is deeper level, not consciousness level. So I think media people also, you see, have important role. You see, occasionally, I think media is should sort of report some sort of sensational thing, or sex, or murder, or these violence, these things. But meantime, occasionally, media should tell people the real peaceful life, very much related with mind. So this, whenever I have the opportunity meeting with media people, I always is telling them, they also have the responsibility is to educate people, not just the material level value, but deeper level, that I feel. And then gradually, you see the people through more complete form of education comes. Then I think these things eventually can change. This is my view.
Your audience, two other questions have come, and if people yes. can just write their names also on this as they're coming up. So two questions. One saying, what inner peace leads to happiness? How does one maintain inner peace and calm with so much turmoil happening outside? And a related question to this is, what happens if you choose inner peace and happiness, but someone around you, due to their inner chaos, tries to shake you again and again?
As I mentioned earlier, you see, if you have some knowledge and some experience, distinction, appearances, and deeper reality, all these, you see, including criticism or some kind of sort of negative attitude, these are superficial. Deeper level, we are same human being, same human brothers, sisters. Even if it's twin brothers, sisters, occasionally some problems, but still basically brothers, sisters. So thinking that line, all these negative the human activities, and including towards you, then consider, oh, these are minor, temporary. Basically, we are same human being. Basically, we are same human brothers, sisters. So that kind of mental attitude really makes differences. As a practitioner, I always consider entire sentient being our mother sentient being. And then, particularly, the 7 billion human beings on this planet is actually brothers, sisters. I always stress, so we all, 7 billion human beings, mentally, emotionally, physically, we are same. So, is it thinking that line, entire human being, it's the same, my brothers, sisters. So with that feeling, wherever I go, I feel, oh, we are same. I meet another human being. If I too much emphasis, I'm Tibetan, you are Indian. And then I'm Buddhist, you are maybe non-Buddhist. If too much emphasis that, then you see create some kind of wall. These are no use. We all sentient beings. So I never consider I'm something special. I never consider I'm just human being. So with that feeling, from early morning, when I meet the every day these days Indian police, I always joking with them, and teasing them, like that. And perhaps I may share one of my sort of experience. I think 2 years ago, one morning, as I usually do, so from my room, go outside and meet greetings some of these policemen. The three police there. So then Mm-hmm. I ask them, what do you think of my age? They say, oh, maybe 70. Then I told them, then at that time, my age, 82. Oh, no, I think 80 years old. So then I told them, my age, 80 years old. Then they, oh, get so surprised. Oh, your face looks like still younger. Oh, then I show my teeth. Look, my teeth.
All intact.
Yes. then I told them, look, my lips, very red, almost like lipsticks use. They say, yes. Oh, then I do that. So everybody laugh. So I never consider I'm Buddhist monk or Dalai Lama. I never consider that. I'm just a human being. So with that, wherever I go, whomever I met, easily, you see, there was a mixing.
Yes.
So that's my own experience. So one practice is intra-sentient being should consider our dear mother. And 7 billion human beings on this planet is actually our dear mother and brothers, sisters. That thinking, very, very sort of useful for me. So we all, and then those theistic religious follower, and think about, you see, we all brothers, sisters of the one, children of one father. Very good, wonderful. Like that. And sometimes we, when we talk religion, then we immediately feel some rituals, some chanting.
Yeah.
That's, if you carry some chanting with understanding the meaning, then quite useful. Otherwise, chanting is waste of time.
Rajit Sinha, I'm again going to combine two questions. Rajit Sinha says, when so many challenges are there before society, how can we upscale efforts towards happiness? And a related question was, should the wider economic system count happiness, somewhat like Bhutan does with gross national happiness?
I think struggle for to also the injustice is itself practice of Dharma. Injustice is the, because of the against religion. Injustice ultimately is related with well-being of other.
Justice.
Justice, yes. So you see, fight because of the injustice.
Yes.
Itself is practice of Dharma. Very good. Instead, you see, the motivation, more compassionate, more sense of caring of other, not salary or some sort of thing. If you give me such amount of money, I will, because I will fight for you. That's wrong.
Tell them.
If lawyer or judge themselves corrupted, then very difficult. And also similarly, sometimes you see some spiritual leaders, some lamas, also a little bit corrupted. That is a really very serious matter. One in Haryana, one lama, one guru, now in prison, isn't it? So they suppose to see person who teach other people the moral or good thing, they themselves is corrupted. Then like medicine become poison, like that. Very unfortunate. So investigation is key factor, not faith. I think, Nalanda tradition. One great thing is, according to Nalanda tradition, some of those masters examine Buddha's own word. A certain word, say, found some contradiction. Then they reject it. Even Buddha's own word, you cannot accept this Buddha's teaching literally, because it goes against reason. Like Nagarjuna rejected some Buddha's own teaching, and Chandrakirti as well. That's really greatness. Even Buddha's own word we examine. Buddha taught, certainly, Buddha, some occasion, his audience, different mental disposition. So he taught accordingly. So that we cannot accept literally. Literally, like that. So the Nalanda tradition, everything, examine, investigate. And to lawyer also, we have to investigate.
Yes. That I'll investigate.
Then also we have to investigate so-called those lamas or teachers. We have to investigate. Should not follow blind faith. Blind faith is very dangerous. Next question.
Right, a question from Pooja. Advice on raising a teenager. What as parents should we not do when bringing up children?
Any action which creates uncomfortable other people, then generally speaking, that should avoid. I think the teenagers way, teenage, young children, I think we can easily ask, do you need friend or enemy? So everybody want a friend. It's a friend. The very basis of friend is a smile and a sincere attitude. That brings trust. Trust brings smile. We have to make distinction. Smile, genuine smile, that brings happiness. Another sort of smile, diplomatic smile. And sarcastic smile. So these smile, all those showing teeth, but that smile is instead of feeling happiness or trust, some more suspicion. Some of the Chinese officials, they are expert artificial smile. I also learned since 51 till 59, I remain with communist officials. So I also learned artificial smile. So like that, the children, automatically they love smile. Mm-hmm. Some occasion I asked, when I talk with a student, I ask them, do you prefer smile or angry face? Everybody say smile. True, even animal. Some dogs, you see, when you show you genuine affection, then their eyes, some different, isn't it? Then because of tail, like that. If while you're giving some food, your eye showing something little negative, then the dog, their tail eventually go down, like that. So animal also, you see, distinction, genuine smile, genuine affection, and just feeding. They make distinction. So, like that, smile, affection, is the key factor for happy individual, happy family, happy community, and finally, happy world should create that way. I think in this respect, I think India can make certain sort of kasoda contribution. Firstly, India's ahimsa, concept of ahimsa, I think should increase that, share with other people, other nations. Ahimsa with karuna, this, I think, India's century-old message, I think now should be, you see, message for entire humanity, in entire world. Yes, next.
Right. Bad relations with neighbors can have an impact on happiness. What do you think India can do to improve relations with China, and how can that, where do you see there's the future of that relationship?
Because a neighbor way. True. I think if you, one of my friend, I think in Australia, I think, you see, one day, you see his car, some smashery, scratch or something. Then, you see, he feel uncomfortable. But then he deliberately visited his neighbor and expressed sorry. Then that moment, there's some negative feeling completely disappear. So then, I think I always is about emphasize the international level, global level. Unfortunately, many problems, including killing, actually human beings' creation. Global warming, that's beyond our control. But then, too many sort of killing and discrimination, all these due to secondary level of differences, different nationality, different religious faith. So a lot of human suffering is actually our own creation. Yet we, a human being, more compassionate in nature. Everybody wants happy life. Yet a lot of problems we created. So this sort of creation of suffering is we too much emphasis differences, nationality, and faith. So the countermeasure for that, we have to go deeper level. We are same human being. Sense of oneness of 7 billion human being. Then different nationality, it's secondary. Different religious faith is secondary. So with too much emphasis, the secondary level of differences, that causing division and causing violence. So in India also, the caste system, this I think the one of the backward tradition that must change. They are also human being. You see, go deeper level of oneness of human being, oneness of Indian. Although I think India, I think East India, South India, West India, North India, Central India, different culture, different language, different script, but all happily remain one union. Wonderful. Wonderful. So therefore, we are not seeking independence from China. Since 1974, we decided eventually we have to talk with Chinese government. So we are not seeking independence. And we are very much sort of willing remain within the People's Republic of China, provided they should implement thoroughly Chinese constitution, certain rights mentioned in Chinese constitution. And also, you see, Chinese constitution recognize the different places and different provinces, actually Tibetan autonomy, Tibetan autonomous district, autonomous prefecture, autonomous karata, ka, region like that. So constitution recognized as a Tibetan area, then all these areas should have same right to preserve our own language, our own culture. Then politically, we are very much want remain within the People's Republic of China. So sometimes I jokingly telling some Chinese friend when we met, almost whole world who are supporting Tibet issue knows we are not seeking independence. But some Chinese media still consider me splittist. So it seems they want me to pursue independent movement. I tell you, sometimes I jokingly tell them, we are not seeking independence. I always admire the firstly Indian Union. Wonderful. Then European Union. Oh, really? Wonderful. During First World War, Second World War, French, German, arch enemy. But after Second World War, they create European Union. Mainly Adenauer of Germany and De Gaulle from France. You see, they create the European Union. I'm quite sure. Since the European Union developed, then last few decades peaceful. If that union not developed, then last few decades, I think some killing among these different nations. So I really admire. Then British, any Englishman here? Godo. Oh, so you are leaving European Union. I have some reservation, but of course this is not my business. Now more and more complain among the British now, isn't it? Regarding Rusi Kasa. Ka. Oh. So now time come together. I often, you see, expressing spirit of European Union now should bring an Latin America union. Then at least Northern Africa, some kind of union. Then Eastern Africa, or Southern, led by South Africa, then some kind of union. Then eventually whole Africa, some union. Then no military forces. Expenditure of military can reduce. In Latin America, once the Costa Rica is indeed demilitarized, only few, only sort of police, otherwise no military forces. So now these things are, I think, wonderful. In order to create peaceful world, peaceful continent, firstly, demilitarize. There are two levels. External disarmament. For sincerely external disarmament, firstly, you should create inner disarmament. More compassionate. On the basis of sense of oneness of our human community. It is possible. True. I think, generally speaking, I think now today's world, I think desire for peace is much increased. Look, during Iraq war, you see, because of about to happen. So many millions of people against violence, against war. Then Also, you see, First World War, Second World War, I think every citizen of the concerned nation declared war, and everybody proudly joined war effort during Vietnam War. Then gradually, against anti-war movement, gradually started. Then European Union also one example. So world changing, humanity, at least in the European continent, European people more experienced too many violence, then they become more mature. I often used to ask some German people, some German as well as some Japanese, do you have some kind of ill feeling, feeling with some kind of revenge towards America, particularly Japan, two nuclear bombs used. So many of them, when I ask, they say, nothing, no sort of ill feeling. That's good. That's good. They have to live side by side. Past is past. Like family, occasionally quarrel. But basically, as one family, live together. Okay, next question.
Right. I'm conscious that we are in fact out of time. So we could carry on for hours, but we are out of time. So I'm just going to try and compress, Your Holiness, 2-3 questions into one. They are somewhat related. What does a person suffering from grief or ill health or the loss of a parent, how does such a person find inner peace or happiness if you are going through grief?
Usually, say, some individual who expressed to me that, I usually say telling them, firstly, one Buddhist text, I think 8th century, one Nalanda master, he expressed, if the tragic situation face, you should analyze that tragic situation can overcome through effort or not. If it is through sort of investigation, if that tragic situation can overcome, then no need to worry. If that tragic situation, no possible to overcome, then no use too much worry. like we, now getting older and older, so sometimes I feel some young people go like that, feel, now I cannot sitting go, I cannot do like that. But then, you see, too much worry, no use. You are getting older and older, nothing. This is one thing, I think, realistic advice or expression. Now, some your dear friend, including parent, passed away. No use too much worry. But instead of worry, one example, when my teacher, senior teacher, when he passed away, I feel very sad because since childhood, he really takes care of me, a great scholar and a practitioner. So during his, because of the alive, right? During his there, I always feel something like solid rock I can lean. When he passed away, and I really feel now no longer that rock, then I'm thinking, instead of worry, sad, I translate that sad situation, translate into increase willpower. Now, I must fulfill my late teacher's wish. I have to, determined to carry his wish. So similarly, when mother or parent or someone dear friend passed away, then you should feel now that person already gone, nothing can be done. Now I must fulfill their wish with enthusiasm, with determination. That I usually telling people. Okay.
Your Holiness, I think we are out of time. Nimit Iqbal has a question, but I think we are out of time now, so we're going to have to end it here. Thank you all so much, and it was such a privilege and a pleasure to hear you, as always, Your Holiness.
Thank you. Thank you.